Chairs No Waiting, episode number 361. Neal Brower interviews Bruce Bilson, 2011, part two. Still very long. Two Chairs No Waiting is brought to you each week by the fine folks over at weaversdepartmentstore.com. Go over to Weavers and check things out. They got some cool things, like right now, the Andy Griffith Show 2016 wall calendar is on sale for $10 because it's January and you need to get one early. You can also pick up a Mayberry trivia book by Scott Hopkins. Got 1,500 trivia questions in it. Great book. Or, favorite by a lot of people, Mayberry Choppers over at weaversdepartmentstore.com. Hello, everybody. I'm Alan Newsom, your host for Two Chairs No Waiting. I want to thank you for joining us. I want to thank our patrons. There's folks that are donating to the show each episode, and I want to thank all of you for doing that. And I want to thank all of you who can't do that just for being here. Thanks for being here and shopping over at Weavers. That's another way to support the show, or you can just share information about it. But I really do appreciate it. I want to thank Neal Brower, and I also want to thank, as I did at the end of the episode last week, Neal and Pat Coleman. Because Neal and Pat Coleman from Remembering Mayberry, they're the ones who provided this wonderful audio and video, depending on whether you're watching the video version of the show or listening to the show, of the interview with Bruce Bilson by Neal Brower at Professor Brower's class back in 2011 at Mayberry Days. Now, last week, if you didn't hear and see that episode, I recommend that you go back and listen or watch it. And I do recommend these series here, this series of episodes, that the video version is worth your time to go in and watch, because it's on stage at the Earl Theater in Mount Airy, North Carolina, and Neal is there with Bruce right there on the stage, and you get to see the video clips that you're going to hear on the audio version, but you actually get to see them. So I definitely want to encourage that. So without further ado, let's head right in here and let's see if we can't hear from Neal and Bruce as they go about the interview. We're joining him back up. Last week he had been talking about the extras that he was in charge of and what they did on stage. And we're going to go right on into that. So take it away.
We listened to the laugh track. Tell us about the laugh track at Desi Lou.
Okay. This is kind of interesting. Andy had worked a lot in front of audiences. And we didn't have an audience on this show. And he said, I think this show will play better and let an audience laugh to it than using whatever we're doing over there. I'd like to perform the show, show it to an audience, and record that track. So we went to the recording studio, and they had hired about 50 people, came and sat, they made a little theater-like thing, and Andy was the MC. And he got up and welcomed everybody and was very warm and gracious and wanted to tell a joke from back down here. And he said there was a lady who bought a new outhouse, and she called the guy who installed it and said, you better come out here, this thing smells bad. So this is his joke, not mine. And so he came out and she said, go on in there, see for yourself. And he went in there a moment or two, and he came back out, and he said, well, lady, you shit in it. And that's the joke that Andy told to this audience. So the experiment didn't work, not because of that joke, but let me tell you about the laugh track, because it's really interesting. A guy named Charlie Douglas was a sound engineer, and he took laughs from the Lucy Show, which was a Desilu show, obviously, and at our studio and our neighbor, and he put all these laughs into a machine, Charlie Douglas's machine. It had knobs, it had buttons on it, and keys, sort of. And he trained a couple of brothers, and one of them was named Carol Pratt, and the other guy, I forget his name, Pratt. And they learned to play these things like an organ. And so when the show was edited, and it went into what we call dubbing, where the music is put in and the sound effects are put in, Carol would sit there with the associate producer. I understand you said Dick Link did it some of the time. And he would laugh according to his own sense of humor. And then you could tell him, I want you to laugh more, less, or put a little right in there, you know? And he did that. And if you were listening carefully, I think you felt, as I always did, that he did a damn good job, that it really, he laughed about the same as I laughed, sitting in my living room. So that's how it was done, and that's how all the sitcoms that were one camera were done, as opposed to, like, I Love Lucy, which was three cameras and an audience.
Bruce, could you comment on the on-set chemistry between Andy Griffith and Don Knotts?
Well, you saw that scene. That's the chemistry. If you watch the shows thinking about how many scenes and how many minutes and how many frames of film, it's the two of them doing a routine or playing a scene. And that's the chemistry. It was there from day one. And it was wondrous, and it was a pleasure to be there. And we were a family. You know, when you're working on a series, the normal day nowadays is 12 hours a day. Come in at 7, go home at 7. We did not work those kind of hours. But we worked a full day, 3 days a week, shooting, and we were together, and we were family. It was a, I've said it probably to a lot of you, I've certainly said it to you, and I've said it to people my whole life. It was one of my very, very favorite shows to work on, even though I was an assistant director rather than a director, which I spent most of my career doing.
We're going to move now back one episode to the new housekeeper. Andy's home life centered around Aunt Bee and Opie. And this scene from the new housekeeper shows the wonderful relationship between Ron Howard and Andy Griffith.
No, I got some thinking to do.
Oh, why? You got some kind of problem?
Well, I got something to ask you. Something important.
Yeah? Well, go ahead.
Can I run away from home?
You want to run away from home? Well, now, if that's what you got on your mind, well, you're going about it all wrong.
I am?
Oh, yeah. You ain't supposed to ask your pa.
But you always said I should never go anyplace far without getting your permission.
Well, yeah, I know I did say that, but see, running away from home's a little special. See, what you do in a case like that is first you write a note saying that you're running away, and then you do.
You mean to tell me that's all there is to it?
That's all.
But I don't know how to write.
That's not right. I'll tell you what, if you are really bound to run away, I'll write a note for you.
You will?
Yes, sir. I'll do it. Now, let's see, when was it you want to leave?
Right away.
Today's Wednesday. And about how long was you thinking on staying?
Why?
Oh, never mind, that stands to reason. If you run away, you run away forever.
What do you mean?
Now, don't bother me, I'm thinking. Dear Pa, I am running away from home, and you will never see me again.
Pa, what are you talking about? When will I ever see you again?
Well, that stands to reason. You've run away, and I'm right here. Now, how are we going to see one another?
No!
What are you doing that for? I didn't finish the note yet.
I don't want you to finish. I don't
want to
run away. I changed my mind.
Oh, I really boy gets the right to change his mind.
I don't want to leave you, Pa.
And I don't want you to leave, Opie. Is it Aunt Bee? Opie, why can't you put Rose out of your mind? Make room for Aunt Bee. If you'll give her a chance, I presume you'll love Aunt Bee as much as you ever loved Rose.
anything like Rose can. She can't fish or hunt frogs or play baseball with me like Rose did.
Gosh.
Now, after seeing that, don't you just want to pick up Ron Howard and hug him? Oh, it's so wonderful. Bruce, what was the on-set relationship between Andy and Ronnie?
Well, you saw it. I mean, that's not made up. Ronnie was so special. I mean, we all loved him. I thought you might be interested that if he had been a year younger, he wouldn't have done this show, because there are child labor laws in California to protect kids who work in films. And 6 years old is where they can work 4 hours a day. And they must have school 3 hours a day, and they must have 1 hour of recreation. And kids younger than that, it would have been so restrictive that I don't think they were looking for a child who was under 6 years old. So he had school every day on the set, whether he was working or not. And because we shot 3 days a week, not five. And when he was in the scene, you know, the camera guys, the crew has to light the scene. We had a little person who stood in for him while the lighting was going on. I'll talk about stand-ins later. And then I would say, "Ronnie, here!" And he'd come running. And I saw him at his mom's funeral, and I reminded him of that. What a nice man he's grown up to be, by the way. And he said, "Sure, I got out of school. Of course I came running." So we all loved him. He was just so good. Now, his dad, Rance Howard, and his mom, Jean, were just the best movie parents I have ever come across. And Rance, if Ronnie was acting up, didn't yell or didn't scream, he just went like this. That was it. And Ronnie shaped right up. But I wouldn't try it if you meet him. And when the season was over, back to public school, back to Little League, all those things that a kid should have as part of growing up, I mean, they were the greatest. And matter of fact, when I went to get this haircut two weeks ago, I was walking up to the barber's, and Rance Howard was coming down with his wife. She had just gotten her hair done. That's a different hairdresser, not my barber, anyhow. And I'll show you later, they even rented a small house one block from the studio on the next street so that Ronnie could go home for lunch, could go home when he was finished right away, not with a long drive in the car. They just did a wonderful job with him, and he did a wonderful job. When he auditioned for The Music Man, he came back and he sang for us, you know, "Gary, Indiana," with the and all that stuff, if you know that song that he sang in the movie. And later on, I was directing an episode of MASH, and all of a sudden, the young soldier came up and said, "Hey, Bruce," and it was Ronnie. I felt like my kid was in the Army. It was really weird. So, and now, of course, he's doing such good work as a mature, talented director.
Sheldon Winter directed the pilot, or the first episode, The New Housekeeper, and Don Weiss directed the next 9 episodes. Episode number 11 was The Christmas Story, and Bob Sweeney directed that episode and 79 others. Why did Bob Sweeney work so well with the cast, and would you share to us about your mentor, Bob, anything that you would like to?
Okay, I'm delighted to. Bob Sweeney had a partner, and they were comics on radio in San Francisco, Sweeney and March. If any of you remember Hal March, he was a host on some game show. And I met Sweeney when he played the brother-in-law on Our Miss Brooks. I don't know if there's enough old folks here to remember all these shows. That was a long time ago. And we sort of became friends, and then I was assistant director on a show called Wyatt Earp, and Bob was an actor in a show called The Brothers, and we knocked him off the air. We were opposite each other. And when I was doing the Andy Griffith Show, one day, Bob Sweeney, my friend, showed up and said, "Sweeney's the name and comedy's the game." And he came, and I don't think he had directed much, if at all, but he came in and started directing. And Don Weiss was a very nice man, and you look at his shows, they're good. And actually, Gene Reynolds, who later was one of the creators of MASH and a very talented, great guy, directed three, I think. And they were feeling around for chemistry, for somebody that Don and Andy responded to. And Sweeney turned out to be that guy. He was a great guy, and funny, and gentle, and Irish, and everything. And he became my mentor, and I left the show after the second season, and I went on a show called Route 66. We traveled all around the country, never shot in a studio, and when I came back, during that time, Sweeney had directed the episode, year three, and he started his own company to make a pilot and try and get his own show on the air. And I joined him, and we got a show on the air called The Baileys of Balboa, and he gave me three to direct. And I was already in the Directors Guild, but now I was a director. And I'm sitting here 397 shows later. So, and I owe it to Bob Sweeney.
I'm going to jump ahead now to the end of the first season. Bruce, comment on the crew wondering if the Andy Griffith Show would be renewed. Tell us a little bit about Tiny's reviews and your gift to Ron Howard at the end of the first year.
Well, let me start with the first day we went on the air. We went on the air on a Monday night like we always did. Now, 10 shows had been shot. And we'd gotten no feedback. We all think we're doing good work, but we don't know what America, what you guys are going to think about this show. And so Tuesday morning, the show was on Monday night, and we're gathered in the makeup room. Lee Greenway, the makeup artist, Bob Sweeney, the director, Don Knotts, Andy Griffith, and me. And so, what did you think? How'd the show go last night? Well, hey, my wife loved it. Yeah. Everybody I talked to loved it. And I said, yeah, you know, when I came to work this morning, Tiny at the gate said, "Great show last night, Bruce." And everybody stopped for a minute. And then Andy said, "Well, that's who I heard it from, too." And then Don, and then Sweeney, and then Lee Greenway. And so the five of us had decided we were a hit with everybody in America because Tiny at the Gate said, "Great show last night." Now, I have to tell you that every Tuesday for the next 2 years I was working there, "Great show last night, Bruce," from Tiny at the Gate. And you wanted to hear about the end of the first season.
Yes. Could you tell us about the General Foods representative and your gift to Ronnie?
I will tell you all that. When you're doing a television series, you come to the end of the number that you're doing, which was 33 in that first year, and it's like February or March, and you've done all your shows, and you're off again until June or July. It's called hiatus, and it's every television show has that. They don't work through. You stop, and the writers also are working on scripts for next year, and the crew looks for jobs and doesn't find them because everybody's out of work. So it's not that you're no good, it's there's no work. So everybody's very anxious to know, especially when you're on a show you love. It's a great job. Not long hours and good material, and you can brag about it at home. Will it get picked up for next season? And you're looking for clues. And Andy was talking about buying a house, a pretty big, nice house. And I heard the guy from General Foods say, Andy, buy the house. And that was it. We're picked up. And so that was how that worked. And as the show ended, on our last day and our wrap party, got to have a wrap party, and the crew had bought Ronnie Howard this big, fancy swing set for him to have during hiatus and while he was being seven, right? So that was the kind of a company we were, and it was great.
Could you tell us very quickly the story about Andy's memorial bronzed moccasin?
Yes, you just told it. Andy, you know, had these miserable-looking loafers that he wore all the time coming to work. And one day, one disappeared. And he was looking for that thing all the time. And he couldn't find it. He was aggravated about it and had to go home with his wardrobe shoes on. And at that wrap party, Lee Greenway came out with that moccasin bronzed. And a little plaque saying the Andy Griffith Memorial Moccasin, and broke him up.
One of Bruce's responsibilities as the assistant director was to hire and direct the extras. Bruce and the other crew and cast of the Andy Griffith Show worked with some wonderful guest stars in the first 2 years. Buddy Ebsen, Alan Hill, Jr., Barbara, Bill Bixby. Barbara Eden, Sterling Holloway. We're going to see just a brief scene now from Opie's Hobo Friend that features Buddy Ebsen. And what I want you to look for is the detail. You're going to see Buddy or Mr. Brown, Dave Brown, and Opie at a gumball machine. And behind them is a plate glass window from a store. And as you watch the scene, notice the extras who are reflected in that window as they walk across the street. Bruce was in charge of directing those extras.
These look very nice. To begin, these have prizes. What does he have both?
Well, I only got one penny.
But you don't need any money, as long as you have a magic touch and know the magic word.
It's like fish talk?
No, no, this is gumball talk. You see? I put one hand under here. Now you watch that hand. And with the other hand, I reach back here. And I say the magic word. Tuscarora. There you are.
Say, that's pretty nifty. How's it work?
Well, you say the magic word, get the magic touch, and the gumball machine gives me the gumball.
But ain't that cheating?
Cheating? Oh, my, no, no, no. Why, this little machine doesn't want your money. What would a gumball machine use money for? Does it have to buy food? Does it have to buy clothes? Or roller skates? Or go to the movies? No, no, it doesn't want your money at all.
It don't even have to buy gum.
So, whether you put in a penny or just give it a pat with a hand, it's just as happy either way. Have another? Tuscarora!
Bruce, tell us a little bit about working with the extras and hiring them. Now, Bob Sweeney, if he directed this episode, would have been in charge of directing Ronnie and Buddy Ebsen, but you would have been in charge of directing the extras in the background. Is that correct?
Right. We didn't call it directing. It was setting the background. And on some shows nowadays, they refer to extras as background artists. And the right extras are important because everybody on a movie set, any one person can hurt you or help you. Even an extra screwing up, maybe not matching something that screws up, he's in two different shots and he doesn't do the same thing twice. Anybody, so, and can help you. I'm diverse, okay? Doing Get Smart, Jaime the Robot had we had a thing that opened up and there were electronics in there that he wore on his chest. and it was supposed to be the bad guys had reprogrammed him. And I was starting the scene with Don Adams with a screwdriver stuck in there, and the prop man whispered something in my ear. And I whispered it in Don Adams' ear. And so the scene opened with the thing, and he poked with the screwdriver and said, "Cough, Jaime." Yeah, somebody got it. Anyhow, that was one of my... But that was the prop man's joy. Jaime went... Now you get it? Okay, anyhow. So our studio was really the comedy capital of Hollywood, even though it was a small studio. Now, the three camera shows used the crew 2 days. They came in and rehearsed everything one day and set all the cameras and did the lighting. And then on the second day, they shot with an audience, and it was I Love Lucy or Dick Van Dyke, you know, and that was how it worked. Now, the other 3 days, that was us. We shot 3 days. So we would shoot Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and like Lucy, or I think it was Armis Brooks, would shoot Thursday and Friday. And our crew, the electricians, and I think the whole sound crew went, and the stand-ins went. So we used those stand-ins on our show. A lot of them were ladies, and they were good people, but it gave them a decent living, and they didn't have to call in every night to try and get an extra job. And then I used people who were not the pretty people, not the people that could go on the dress, what they call dress extras, where you wear your own long dress, your own tuxedo. They were not the handsome people, but they were great and grateful, and they would work for me, and they would do anything. And sometimes you'll see somebody mowing along way up the street, or somebody taking their shoes into the shoemaker. And those were my gang. And they then, when they brought their cars, they got an extra check for having their car there as well. So, and then extras work in several categories. Basic extras made, I don't know, like 15 bucks a day. I don't remember exactly. And then there was called special business, which was a $7 raise, right? And then there was a, and that would be maybe the whole crowd yelling something together might be special business in the pickle show or something like that. And then if there was somebody, like in this one you're going to see when they're all in jail, and he says to the guy, "How are things at the bank?" Right? That guy didn't say anything, but that's a silent bit, where he's referred to as a character. And I tried to spread that stuff around among the people.
All right. So, folks, there we are. That was part two of our interview that Neal Brower did with Bruce Bilson, the assistant director of the Andy Griffith Show. I hope you guys are enjoying this. He has so much amazing information. I definitely think you should go back and listen again, even if you listened. If you're a big fan of the Andy Griffith Show or you're just interested in how they make television shows, this is a class for you, because the information he's providing is amazing for not just fans, but for anybody who's interested in television. I believe it's really nice. At the beginning of the show, I misspoke. I said he would be, last week he had talked about extras. Well, obviously he ended up talking about extras this week because, you know, I've been watching these videos. so I got confused about which one. So definitely, even I need to go back and watch last week's episode. If you enjoyed this week's, make sure you watched last week's part one as well. All right, folks, we're going to head on out of here, but I've got a couple of things I want to do. I want to thank our executive producer of Two Chairs No Waiting. I didn't say it up front. For episode number 361 is Larry Granger. So thank you, Larry. And we got a great voicemail, so I want to play that for us. So I'm going to play this for you, and then we'll play the going away music. So I want to remind you to give me a call at 888-684-8415, or you can email me at floyd@imayberry.com and let me know what you think about these episodes. All right, so let's go and listen to Diana. And, folks, we'll see you next week right here on Two Chairs. So this is a great story, so y'all enjoy it. And we'll see you later.
Hey, Alan. This is Diana. I'm from Texas. I'm Clara in the chat room. I've missed being there the last 2 or 3 weeks, but I have been listening to the podcast. My brother also listens to him. He's my younger brother, and he lives in Florida. And so we ran into each other at Culver City last night, but not really. He was watching the, or listening to one or the other, the Andy Griffith Show, Mayberry podcast, your podcast. And I was just scrolling through YouTube and happened upon this documentary about the Little Rascals. And they got into the Culver City and where the Little Rascals were filmed. And then, which was the 20s and 30s, and then now, and which was in the 70s when this was made. And I saw some of the buildings that my brother and I had seen when we visited Culver City together 3 or 4 years ago. So I texted him and said, hey, you got to watch this documentary on the Little Rascals about Culver City. And then I got up this morning and looked at my text, and he was texting on a different stream, and he said, hey, you got to listen to the Mayberry podcast. This week and the next 3 weeks, they're going to have a lot of different things, and you'll see something about Culver City. And so I guess we were not talking on a party line, but we were talking with a receiver on each ear or something, however you'd call it. It was funny. And it just looks like we're going to have to come back to Mayberry Days pretty soon and get another Mayberry fix. Thank you, and thanks for the show. Bye-bye.